I'd like to welcome the 115th president of the Royal Canadian Institute to the stage, Mr. Peter Love.
Thank you very much. I don't feel that old, but I guess that's what I am. So my name is Peter Love, and I'm really delighted to be here and welcome you, ladies and gentlemen. And this is our Sanford Fleming Award ceremony, as I'm sure you all know. I'm really proud to be the president of the RCI. Our mission is simple. We provide a platform for public engagement with prominent Canadian and international scientists through free live lectures, events, and webcasts. And I think many of you have been to some of those events, and I hope you'll come to more of them. As I said, the organization, RCI Sciences, was established in 1851 by a royal charter from Queen Victoria, and the Royal Canadian Institute for Science remains the oldest scientific society in Canada and one of the oldest organizations in Canada. And as many of you probably figured out, it actually predates Canada as an organization. We recently had an issue where we went to the bank and showed them our charter, and they'd never seen anything like it. They were looking for some incorporation papers from this thing called Canada, and we actually didn't have them because we were created before this thing called Canada existed. So that was sort of neat. The goal of our organization was always to connect new discoveries to people. When Sir Sanford Fleming and his fellow surveyors, engineers, and entrepreneurs first got together, they realized that there was a great deal of interesting research that was happening in this young country, but few ways to share it. That became the Institute's role, to connect people and ideas. And we're attracted by the concept of preserving special land. One of the things they did early on was this idea of preserving special pieces of land. And one of them for future generations, and one of those pieces of land was the Algonquin Park. And early members of our society were involved in the creation of that park. Other important events in our past include a collection of pre-colonial artifacts, and members recognize that these should be on display and there should be a museum in Toronto, and that resulted in the creation of the Royal Ontario Museum. And, of course, there's time zones. And I think we all know Sir Sanford Fleming first presented his idea to the public at a meeting of the Royal Canadian Institute. So it's an idea that has been adopted worldwide. And I think where we travel, people talk about it. They may not know it was Sanford Fleming, but people often recognize that, and it's something we should all be very proud of. And it's a very recognizable Canadian contribution to the world. In the past, the Institute has published journals, and we have some of them that are, as I said, over 150 years old. Now we open our talks to everyone, and I think many of you attended, and we record them so they're available to be viewed online. The way people interact with science may be different now, but the idea remains the same. And in the words of our founder, Sanford Fleming, the Royal Canadian Institute was a forum for the exchange of scientific ideas that would, as he said, do great good to my adopted country. In the spirit of our founder, the Royal Canadian Institute recognizes excellence in science communication and outreach with the Sanford Fleming Medal and Citation. This was first awarded in 1982 and goes to a Canadian who has made an outstanding contribution to the public understanding of science. It is my pleasure now to invite Dr. Risa Moretti, the Minister for Research, Innovation and Science for the Ontario Government, to the stage to say a few words and then present the medal. Dr. Moretti.
Well, thank you very much, Peter, for that kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, it's truly a great pleasure to be here this evening. I am really honored to be here to celebrate the remarkable achievements of this year's Fleming Medal recipient, Ivan Semeniuk. Ivan has been an incredible gift for making science exciting and accessible to everyone. He is able to distill complex scientific concepts into easy-to-understand language. This is a very important skill. It bridges the gap between the lab and the public. Clear science communication helps people understand why scientific research is so vital and how breakthroughs can make a real difference and impact on people's lives. It's essential for people to understand why research matters, because the work done in the lab may one day lead to cure for cancer, a new source of drinking water, or the next disruptive technology that changes our lives. Of course, there is another very important reason why science communication is important. It gets kids excited about science. When they see shows like Cosmos Vistas, they dream about traveling to planet Mars. They strive to learn more about how gravity works and why our solar system is the way it is. It piques their curiosity and inspires them to pursue a life of science. That is good for all of us in this country, because we need more scientists to fuel our knowledge-based economy of tomorrow, to drive next generation of discoveries, and cement our province of Ontario's place as a global leader in research and innovation. That is a key priority for our government. Ladies and gentlemen, the global economy is moving so fast, and we need to keep pace. We are already making great strides in Ontario, but we need to do more to build on that momentum. Our government has a plan to embrace the innovation economy and set the province of Ontario on a path of higher economic growth for years to come. The plan is called the Business Growth Initiative. It's helping to move us towards new areas in economic growth in the knowledge-based economy of today. It's an aggressive economic strategy. It builds on the province's existing strengths, like our highly skilled workforce, vibrant innovation ecosystem, and a strong business climate that we have created in our province. Research and innovation play a key role in our economic growth strategy. We recognize that we need to be ahead of the curve. That means we need more scientists, more innovators, and more people pushing further the envelope. That's why people like Ivan are so essential for our society. Ivan, you are inspiring our next generation of scientists, and your enthusiasm for new discoveries is contagious for all of us. Ivan, this medal is very well deserved. You are raising the bar for Ontarians. And thank you for everything you do to make science accessible to us all. I cannot wait to see what will be next, what you will be doing next. And it is very essential, ladies and gentlemen, to explain science to public. This is a very important subject, and it is not easy, because the public, they learn or they understand in another language, and the scientists, they speak in another language. They speak in the language of numbers, and the scientists, they speak in the language of mathematics. So translation of from one language to the other language, we need people like Ivan. So thank you very much for doing that. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my privilege to present you with this year's Fleming Medal and Citation from the Royal Canadian Institute for Science. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating Ivan Semeniuk. Ivan.
Before you say a few words, I also have a notice and a greeting from Lieutenant Governor, November 15, 2016. It is with great pleasure that I extend my warmest congratulations to Ivan Semeniuk as he receives the 2016 Sanford Fleming Medal and Citation. Ivan, you are one of my personal heroes. Since 1982, this distinction has played a preeminent role in recognizing those who have led in raising scientific literacy among Canadians. Ivan is no stranger when it comes to forging connections between citizens and science. He has creatively done so to frequent acclaim throughout his career as a researcher, instructor, writer, editor, reporter, and broadcaster. At a time when science increasingly holds answers to so many of the challenges our society faces, Ivan's contributions are more valuable than ever. He is a source of inspiration to all in the academy, and we would be wise to follow his example as we seek to inspire among the next generation a renewed sense of wonder about our changing world. On behalf of the people of Ontario, I thank Ivan for embodying the ideals Sir Sanford Fleming had in mind when he founded the Royal Canadian Institute for Science 167 years ago. Please accept my very good wishes for an enjoyable evening, Elizabeth Dowswell. Ivan, there you go. There you go.
I'll leave it to the floor, man. Thank you. Okay, how's that? Great. Well, I want to say thank you very much to Peter, to Kirsten, to Dr. Maridi, and to the Royal Canadian Institute for this incredible honor. I'm speechless, in fact. Something that doesn't happen a lot in my household. I want to say that when I heard about this, when the Institute contacted me, of course, it's a tremendous recognition and a reward for many years of communicating science and for reporting on science in Canada and abroad. But I'm really not seeing it in that way so much. I appreciate the recognition, and it's very rewarding, especially to be here with so many people that mean so much to me and to all of you. I really feel that I'm speaking to my community tonight. But I see it also, perhaps more so, as a responsibility, as a kind of urging to continue this work, to continue to try to reach readers at the Globe and Mail, for example, to illuminate, to inform, illuminate people about the world around us, to inform decision making, and to inspire. And I appreciate that word, inspire. It's not something that journalists set out to do, but there's no doubt about it. It's by exposure to the ideas that are out there in the world and to the people who are enacting change and discovering new things about the world, that's an inspiring thing, and that leads new people to go further. And, you know, we are, it, it's a, It's a tricky business when you're a journalist accepting recognition, because there's always this issue about I've got a community that's approving, but does that mean it's because I'm telling them what they want to hear, or should I be saying something that people need to hear? Because we are, of course, in the business not just of finding exciting ideas about the world around us, but also of trying to understand how we can manage this planet going forward, how to improve welfare and well-being for all in our country and beyond, and for us to have a positive role as citizens, and for Canada to have a positive role in the world. So these are the things that we all need to be thinking about, and in some small way, science journalism, science communication needs to be a part of that as well. So I'm especially delighted that we're having this gathering tonight here at this theater, because first of all, they have great AV, but also because we're just steps away from the place where I can put my finger on it and say, that's when I wanted to become a scientist, or that's when I became enchanted by the idea of science and the discovery of the universe. It was just right across the street at what used to be the McLaughlin Planetarium. I didn't grow up in Toronto, but I came here often, and I remember I was about 8 years old. My sister, Alexandra, who's in the audience tonight, took me to the planetarium. I think we were at some banquet or kind of extended family gathering, and it was getting boring for me, and so she took me to the planetarium, and it blew my mind. It blew my mind. It was a wonderful experience, just completely opened my eyes. I became excited about all sorts of astronomy and cosmology, but other areas of science as well. Before long, I grew up near Windsor. Before long, I had joined the local chapter of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. I'm still a member of the RASC here in Toronto, and that led me to pursue astronomy and physics in university, actually here at U of T. So, but that flashpoint, I just remember sitting in that theater and seeing the stars come out, and for me, that was an ignition point. Although there were also other important steps along the way, and growing up in a rural area with lots of nature around was definitely a big part of it too. So it's interesting because it was around the same time, around the time I was 8 or 9 years old, and I've got kids who are around that age right now, that I also discovered I'd like to write stories. But I saw that as a very separate part. It's almost like it's just like another part of my brain doing something else. It would take about another 20 years before I realized that what I most wanted to do was to put those two things together and write stories about science. And it would take almost another 25 years before I was doing it, before I had the privilege of doing it as the science reporter for the Globe and Mail. So in addition to the recognition and to the responsibility, the other thing I want to say is I feel that this medal, this award this year is a really a validation for the Globe and Mail, for Phil Crawley, the publisher, for Dave Walmsley, the editor-in-chief, who's here this evening, for John Stackhouse, who hired me at the Globe and Mail, for all the editors I work with. I say this because you've got to believe me, it is not easy. It's not easy to take a full-time salaried staff position in a newsroom that has to cover all of Canada, all the world, from Capitol Hill to the Arctic to all the bureaus everywhere you can imagine, and take one full-time position and say, we're going to have someone just write about science. That is an incredible thing, and I think that actually needs to be hyped. I'm not saying that because it's my job. I'm saying that because it's a job. And I'm lucky enough to be the holder of that job, but I think it's very important. I think it's serving Canadians very well. I was one of those people who always thought the Globe and Mail should have more science, and it was very fortunate to be in a position where I could do something about that. So I wanted to just, in the time that I have, I'm going to try to not take too much time, but I thought, in that sort of big span of time from walking into the walking into the McLaughlin Planetarium and kind of having my mind blown, and then walking into the Globe and Mail, where, you know, every day, picking up the phone, talking to researchers around the world. In fact, I was a little bit late getting here this evening because, actually, I'll tell you why a little bit later, but I'm on the phone a lot, as you can imagine. So anyway, the distance between those two points crosses some interesting places, and I heard recently that the best nonfiction does one of two things. It either makes a case or it tells a story. And in the best case, it does both. So I'm going to try to do a little bit of both. I have a small case to make to you, but also I want to tell you a few stories about how it all came to be. So let me see if I can just move forward. And of course, I have to explain this title for my talk, which I'll get to. First of all, I just want to say thank you again to the Royal Canadian Institute, and it's quite a pleasure to think of this award being named after Sir Sandford Fleming, of course, for his seminal role in co-founding this institute, and for all of the ways that he made an impact in Toronto life, Canadian life, and in the world. And I think, you know, I have this picture of Sir Sandford Fleming here as a sort of younger man. He was quite young when he was involved in setting up the institute, and in a lot of his early surveying and engineering days. We're used to seeing sort of pictures of him as kind of an older, a senior representative of Canada now. But I think if we could talk to him at this point, kind of earlier in his career, he would be really pleased to hear that the Royal Canadian Institute had such staying power. That, you know, it's clearly something that he felt that Upper Canada needed, and he would be pleased to know that it has carried on through the generations. And I'm saying this because I think it's very appropriate, because I feel that this medal is also showing every sign of doing the same thing, that it's moving through the generations, and I may be one really good example of that. So if there's one thing I want to point out, it's that I may be the first winner of this medal who knows all the other winners. I'm not quite sure, but almost. But not just, I mean, most of them I've known or interacted with, but many of them I know very well. And by that I mean that they've influenced me, they've mentored me, they've been important in my development as a communicator and reporter of science. Here are just a few examples. Here are some researchers who have made tremendous contributions to public outreach and to the public education of science. You know, I still remember meeting Tuzo Wilson my first day on the job at the Ontario Science Centre. He took out the $20 bill and showed me which was Mount Tuzo that his mother had climbed. I remember meeting Helen Sawyer Hogg, her telling me about seeing Comet Halley in 1910. I want to especially thank John Percy, who is well known. I first encountered John Percy as the author of the Observer's Handbook. I remember getting my first copy. I was about 12 or so, I think I have now. I just got my 40th copy or so. I've got this shelf full of the Observer's Handbook. And of course, later when I met John, I got to learn how dedicated he was as a professor of astronomy at U of T to science education in Ontario and also around the world. And, you know, occasionally, even now, I pick up the phone and I'll talk to friends that I made, other areas of journalism, especially reporting on astronomy and so on, and I realize some of these are people that John introduced me to, lifelong friends. At a certain point, I think he realized that there were other people like me out in the world and encouraged me to meet them. Paul Delaney, a kind of a partner in crime at York University in astronomy education when I was at the Science Center. And more recently, I want to point out people like John Dirks, former president of the Gardner Foundation, who I worked with a lot in the last few years, talking about the Gardner Awards. Molly Scheuchet, the last award winner, who I interact with frequently, who's very supportive of efforts to provide some science journalism instruction to graduate students at U of T. So these are all scientists who have made a huge mark in public education here in Toronto, in Canada, and they've also made a mark in my own life. I also want to point out other winners of this award who I consider colleagues, people I've either worked with directly or have influenced me very directly. I'm sure you'll recognize a lot of these people. 2 years ago, Penny Park won the prize, senior producer at Discovery Channel. When I worked with her, she now runs the Canadian Science Media Center of Canada. Peter Calamai, another winner, former Toronto Star science reporter, veteran science reporter, who's given me lots of good advice since I came on at the Globe and Mail about life in the newspaper world and reporting on science in the newspapers. And, you know, two role models early on, Bob McDonald, who had the same position I had at the Science Center a little bit before me, and of course he's well known for his work at Quirks and Quarks and CBC, a kind of adventurer of science that I've often interacted with, and Jay Ingram, one of the best interviewers I know in any area of journalism, you know, one of the most acute minds, and we're very lucky that Jay is, you know, in our country and continuing to write and to bring fabulous kind of science television and science ideas to the broad public. So these are all people that I've had really close ties with, and they've been a huge influence. But I want to single out one in particular, and he happens to be here this evening, but I really have to say that if there's one mentor above all who has been influential for me over a huge span of years, it's been Terence Dickinson, of course known for his Night Watch and many other books, and also for founding in the 1990s Sky News Magazine, which really was one of my first platforms where I could write on a regular basis. So this happened about the same time that Discovery Channel came on the air. Terry is an incredible editor, incredible in the sense that he's very patient and never gets too flustered when we're getting close to deadline. But for more than two decades, I worked with him submitting articles to Sky News Magazine. It was tremendously important for me to be able to do that. Out of all the copies of Sky News, I pulled this cover story out because it was my first cover story for Sky News, so I remember that. And I was looking back, I was thinking, wow, I have actually contributed to Sky News longer than I've been involved in any other professional association in my life. That's amazing. It's been wonderful for me, but it also says something else. Terry actually gave me my first paid writing job, not as an editor. I think he was too busy, and he there was a review that needed to be done for Canadian Geographic, so he recommended me instead of doing it himself. So that actually was my first paid gig as a writer, doing this book review for Canadian Geographic, and I remember taking my wife out for dinner with the check. So that was in 1994. So he gave me the first story, and of course soon after that I was writing for Terry all the time. But also the story I can't really write because I'm too close to it. But Terry's just retired after 25 years. Imagine keeping a magazine going in such a small market, and it's still one of the best astronomy magazines, if not the very best astronomy magazine in the world, and I just want to thank Terry. It's amazing. It is not easy to maintain that level of quality over 25 years, and it's still a fabulous magazine, now edited just in the past year under Gary Saronic. I was looking around. Terry and I have mostly interacted with each other by email, which is a funny kind of relationship over 20 years. But I did dig around, and I found one picture of him on top of the Very Large Telescope in Chile when we were on a trip in 2009. We were both on the same trip. I know Terry, it looks like he's looking for the exit or something in this picture, but we were both on the roof of the VLT, and we were there all night long as the sunset and the dark skies were unveiled like a curtain, like in a grand theater, and the Milky Way was there bright enough, you know, as they say, that you feel like it's casting a shadow. It was a fabulous night, and followed by many long stories in the science reporting trade. So it's something I cherish very much. I want to point all of this out because these days, as a science writer for the Globe and Mail, when I walk in to to a room full of researchers, I sometimes feel like this. I feel like everyone's looking at me like an endangered species. In fact, I sometimes get the introduction, he's Canada's best science journalist because he's the only science journalist. So I want to dismiss this idea right away, because in addition to acknowledging all the many mentors and people who have influenced me and my development, I also want to talk about all the people who are in my generation or younger who I've worked with as an editor, and there are dozens of them. And even in Canada, you think, oh, who else is writing about science? I can name a dozen right now. And in fact, I just quickly went online today and just kind of started pulling down from their Twitter feeds. So here are five great Canadian science writers who are working right now. All of these are mainly freelancers. Nicola Jones Bryant. You see them all. There's Dan Falk, of course. Hannah Hope. They're all Jenny Carpenter's here in Toronto. Brian Owens is out in New Brunswick. They're all fabulous, and I could keep doing this. I could show you another two or three or four more slides just like this. Their work is fabulous. You don't see it in the newspaper so much because of a peculiarity about how science journalism works in Canada. But they are Canadian, they are working in Canada, and there are, I'm not saying that it's crowded, but I'm certainly not the only person doing this kind of work. Sometimes when I explain to people how the business works in Canada and why Canada is a bit different, I talk about the different publications that I've had the privilege of working for. Here are three that I've been on staff. I was a news editor at Nature, based in Washington. I was a bureau chief for New Scientist, a British magazine, but I was the bureau chief in Boston. And of course, I work today for the Globe and Mail. And these I find are exemplary of kind of the three types of audiences that science journalists typically work for, or that write for. And here are those three audiences. So, in the Nature category, you've got what I would call the professionally interested audience. These are people who are reading your publication because they are researchers, or it's their job to keep track of what researchers are doing in science. So that's the smallest circle, but it's a very specialized group. They are the professionally interested audience. Then there's the casually interested audience. These are people who might be reading about science as a kind of intellectual entertainment. They just want to find out what scientists are doing. And it's often, sometimes it's scientists reading about other disciplines, or, it's educators. It's all kinds of students. Lots of people are casually interested in science, but they are looking for information about science. And then you've got the casually disinterested audience. So that's not disparaging at all. What I mean by that is that for someone who picks up the Globe and Mail or the New York Times, or turns on CBC News, they are looking for news, not science. Science might end up being part of the news, but they're not specifically looking for it. But it might come up as part of their news digest. Now, you might wonder, what's the difference writing to all of these different audiences? What's it like? Do you have to dumb it down? Do you have to do this? The answer is there's no difference, actually. All of the audiences of these publications are all the same in that they are interested, educated, adult, non-specialists. Even the Nature audience, non-specialists. I mean, they're specialists in their own field, but the microbiologist who's reading about cosmology in Nature is a non-specialist. So you still have to reach that wide mark and try to make it accurate, brief, clear, do all the things that you would do for all the other audiences. Now, the reason I'm telling you all of this is because here's where Canada is different. If we went over to London or Washington or New York, you could find a large pool, you know, or modest pool anyway, of people working in all of these levels of science journalism, writing for all these different audiences, and they trade back and forth, and they, you know, get married and switch jobs and do all and get married to each other and all sorts of things. You know, and you go to a pub or something like that, and you just see, you know, the room is teeming with science writers because there are all these different levels. It's a kind of an ecosystem. People pop back and forth. Maybe they're with Nature, now they're at New Scientist, now they're at The Guardian, that sort of thing. This is what we lack in Canada, because we have the largest circle of publications. We have the Globe and Mail. We tend to have publications that are, you know, business, politics, things that Canadians need to know about. Our science publications tend to come from outside of Canada. So, and often they're terrific. I mean, Scientific American, National Geographic, you name it, Science, Nature, but they're coming to us from outside of Canada. So what that means is, even though Canada is a small part of the entire scientific world, simply by, you know, the number of people that are doing science in Canada and the amount of money that we invest in science in Canada, even though it's small compared to the globe, our coverage of science in Canada is small compared to what it should be, you know, for all the people that are doing amazing research here in Canada and all the things that, that Canadians are involved in the world of science. Because these other publications aren't necessarily going to be writing from a Canadian perspective. So what that means at the Globe and for other people who are sort of working in that broader audience, there's sort of an extra onus, extra impetus to try to capture some of those stories that maybe otherwise wouldn't be reported, because there's that sense that, you know, if you're going to be a sports writer, you at least have to explain that there's a thing called a hockey game and they play it on ice and there's, you know, the skates and sticks and so on. So that we're doing a little bit of that just to try to make sure people are aware that, in fact, there is science going on right around us and amazing people doing it, and tough questions too, and tough questions need to be asked, and we need to ask, are we spending the money in the right way and are we funding the right people? All of that needs to be happening. And so, you know, it's that smaller pool. And the other now there are some exceptions, Sky News, Quirks and Quarks and so on, but it's a smaller pool. So when all the science writers in Canada get together in the pub, it's like a smaller group, and they're kind of dispersed geographically, so you don't see them very often. But what that means is there's less mentorship, there's less trading back and forth, there's less competition, even just kind of, oh wow, you know, just trying to step up your game as you see what other people are doing. So that has a knock-on effect on how much of our own science we're aware of as Canadians. I went just a month ago, my family and I went to the Toronto Metro Reference Library and saw an exhibition on maps. And, you know, I bring this up because here's an illustration of why we need good science journalism in Canada. So here's a map from, I think it's around 715 or so, Arthur Moll, famous map. It's famous, it's called the Beaver Map, actually. It's famous for this picture that's in the center, and I'm going to zoom in on the picture. I'm not sure if I can, I think I can read, yes. So I want to draw your attention to this because, of course, the map maker never went to Canada. You know, the map maker's in London, but, you know, he drew the map. But a view of ye industry of ye beavers of Canada in making dams to stop ye course of a rivulet in order to form a great lake about which they build their habitations. To effect this, they fell large trees with their teeth in such a manner as to make them come... Crips, ooh, I don't know what that is. And then to lay in foundation of ye dam, they make mortar, work up and finish ye whole with great order and wonderful dexterity. So, you know, if you read the paragraph, it's reasonably accurate. You know, okay, they fell trees, they take mud, and this, you know. But then if you look at the picture, you know, it's like a whole work crew. You know, and they've got like they've got like little mud cakes on their tails, and you know, and over here it almost looks like they've hired bears or something. I know. Anyway, the picture is really, really different. So for anyone who's ever worked with a graphics person over the phone, and you're trying to have, you know, like the graphic that illustrates your story. But anyway, that just goes to show how easy it is to get the wrong idea. And so someone's concocted this fabulous picture based on, you know, what might have been a reasonable account. So anyway, there are more serious examples of that. In the same exhibition, though, was this map, and there were some others, too, that Sir Sanford Fleming was involved with as a young man of Toronto. There's some great maps in the Toronto Library's collection of Sanford Fleming, Sanford Fleming's work as a surveyor. And I just want to bring this up because I do feel like, and it's, you know, having received this award this evening, I feel like Sanford Fleming has somehow been kind of mapping out my life in a way that I didn't realize it at the time. But, you know, when I look at these old maps of Toronto, you know, you can see the beginnings of University College up there. You can see the place, you know, where we're standing now. You can see, you know, I can see a number of the places I inhabited, you know, through my formative years. You know, and I can look down to Front and Spadina, where the Globe and Mail is for another 3 weeks before we move our offices down to King Street East. But I even can see, you know, there's Victoria Square, which is next to the parking lot where I park in the morning sometimes. So it's amazing to see the city taking shape and to be inhabiting that same city with all its history, but to realize that it was kind of Sanford Fleming who was visualizing that city and kind of taking the ferocious beavers and so on. And you know, this is about 150 years later, but you can see how much of a difference it is. It's a much more orderly world. And obviously he was trying to bring order and clarity to our sense of the world. The time zones as well. So this is where I'll fill in the gap I said earlier, one reason why it took a little longer to get here today. So without Sir Sanford Fleming, we wouldn't have time zones. It was an amazing contribution in the late 19th century. As a reporter, I deal with time zones constantly because I'm familiar with them, thank goodness, because my background is in astronomy. So, you know, you spend a lot of time, if you're an undergraduate in astronomy, just, you know, in those days it was with the Astronomical Almanac and you do all these calculations and so on and work out sidereal time and solar time and universal time and all these things. So I'm well acquainted with time zones, but I'm constantly having to work out, you know, when I phone someone up in Europe or elsewhere, where is it? And you know, just today I am writing a story about coral reefs. We've got a researcher from the University of Victoria, or the University of Victoria has a researcher out there in the South Pacific, and you know, we agreed to talk, but you know, she was behind me, of course, in time when she was in Hawaii when we last spoke. She's crossed the international date line, and she hadn't realized that she was now 19 hours ahead of me. So the call never came on Monday afternoon. It's like, oh, I wonder what happened to my coral researcher. And of course, just as we're getting ready to leave, this satellite call from the South Pacific comes. It's like, you got to keep track of Sanford Fleming here. So anyway, but we got the story. So that was good. And it's amazing having the ability to talk to Canadian researchers all around the world and to be able to do it at the right time, thanks to Sanford Fleming. Sanford Fleming was an immigrant, and I come from a family of immigrants. My parents both immigrated to Canada quite some time ago. Our family is really spread out in time. Here's a photo of my mother's side of my family from 1926. This is before they were in Canada. I realize I don't have the a pointer with me, but this, you know, the gentleman in the middle with the big bushy mustache is my great-grandfather, Isidore Tasky. And to his left is my grandmother, surrounded by her three children. At that point, she would have two more eventually, but the girl with the bow on her head, that's my mom in 1926. So she was about 5 years old at the time. I've got Nico here who's six. She didn't realize that she'd be heading to Canada in 10 years. She really resisted that idea, but it was the decision of the century for my grandfather. My grandfather, Alex Zinn, is on the far left in the back row. and was informed enough about what was happening in Europe to decide to take the chance to bring his family to Canada. So they came in 1937. And as I say, the decision of the century for my family, and I'm very grateful to all of them, and to my mother especially, who just passed away 3 years ago. This is my father at age 17. He was in Canada in the late 20s as a 17-year-old. I think they took this picture just before he went. And one of his first jobs was helping to build a railroad up to Churchill, Manitoba. He then later ended up in Ontario and in Windsor, Ontario, where he and my mother met, and you know, the rest is history. But I mention this because I think of I never really got to know my father. He passed away when I was just 3 weeks old. And my mother carried on and got the other, my older siblings were in university and kind of getting their lives started. And there I was, this little baby coming along. So, but I think of my father often, and especially when I'm in Windsor, because one of the things, my parents owned a restaurant. They were typical immigrant family, stressing education, stressing hard work. And but one thing my father did in his spare time was he was like spare time when you're running a restaurant. He was chairman of the building committee for the local Ukrainian Orthodox parish, and they built a cathedral in Windsor. So there's this, you know, on Tecumseh Road in Windsor, there's this fabulous, beautiful church, the St. Vladimir's Ukrainian Orthodox Cathedral. And of course, when I drive by, it's very humbling for me because I'm thinking, in his spare time, my dad got a cathedral built. And there's just no way I can match that. But in homage to him, I just want to say that, of course, I'm very grateful. I'm sure he would have loved to have been here. But I also think of him because of the theme of my talk this evening, which is this idea about the cathedral and the canary in the cathedral. So kind of bring it all back here. You know, if you study science, you often have sort of a little piece of it, various disciplines, you know, gradually, incrementally growing, learning about the world. And there's that kind of metaphor. In fact, it's more than a metaphor. If you really write about science a lot, you kind of have the step. I think journalists have this luxury where they can step back and look at what all the researchers are doing. And it does look very much like the building of a great cathedral. That, you know, science is the greatest cathedral in a way that the human race has managed. Over a 500-year period now, you know, kind of from the beginning of the Enlightenment, gradually, you know, chiseling away at facts and gathering data and kind of making this marvelous construct. So it's humbling, but at the same time, you know, it's... It also needs observers, and I feel that's sort of the metaphor for the journalist. And so I was trying to imagine, you know, where does the journalist fit into the cathedral with all these wonderful researchers building this great edifice of human knowledge? Well, there are canaries in the cathedral. There are birds in the cathedral. Sometimes they might be crows in the cathedral. But the idea is that there are living things flitting around that are keeping an eye on all of this and commenting on it, and maybe even pecking away at it sometimes. There are places where maybe it needs to be pecked at. So it's both that sort of pecking, it's the ability to peck and the ability to sing that I think defines what the role of the journalist is in society. And even though building a cathedral is very important, you've got to have some room for some birds in there. And that's sort of an appeal for me, because I think we're getting good now in Canada at recognizing that science is an important part of our culture, but we also need to consider, how is that science going to be covered? How are we going to know about it? How are we going to question it? How are we going to know if it's going in the right direction? There's still a need for that function as well. It's not as costly, but it still needs to be considered. So I'm going to finish off with 6 episodes. It would be a terribly, it would be a tedious evening for you if I tried to thank everyone, tried to go through, the various roles that I've had, that I've been fortunate to have in my time communicating science. But I thought I'll pick out 6 little things that might just give you a little glimpse into how you build a science journalist in Canada. And of course, I'll do it journalist style. So this will be like journalism 101. What's the first thing you learn about writing the news? Even if you're not a journalist, you know. Don't bury the lead. That's a good one. Still happens sometimes. What are the things you're supposed to bring with you when you go out? Questions, of course. What are the questions that you ask? Who, what, where, when? Exactly. The five W's and the H, right? It's the classic news instruction. And, you know, it's of course, a truism, but it's easily forgotten. I mean, it's not just about writing pretty words. It's about asking questions. It starts with asking questions, and it continues with asking questions. So here are my favorite answers to the six questions. And I'm going to keep them short, but here's how. When I think of the how question, then I think of my time at the Ontario Science Center. I was there for 13 years, and you know, it was incredibly formative for me. It's the time where I learned to get up and talk in front of an audience, to be able to explain things. I got to run my own planetarium. I went overseas. I interacted with people building museums elsewhere. So you know, it was a very, very rich experience with wonderful colleagues, some of whom are here this evening. I'm just going to pick out one thing. And it's not even going to be about the planetarium. In the early 1990s, the Science Center got the contract to do an exhibition for the 100th anniversary of the American Psychological Association, the APA. And we created a whole set of exhibits called Mindworks. Hooley McLaughlin oversaw this. It was a fabulous exhibition because it really tried to capture what was going on in psychology at that time, in cognitive research, in all areas of brain science. And this is back in the early 90s. So this is before the fMRI revolution, the imaging revolution. But it was amazing to see what was happening. And before we worked on that exhibit, a battery of researchers came in to speak to us about their work. So for me, it was very much like the precursor to being a journalist. And one of the exhibits that I was involved in, one of the ones I came up with, I helped come up with, were these things called the word wheels. And I've got these pictures here because they're still on the floor of the Science Center right now. It's very simple. They're just nine wheels. Each wheel has 10 faces, and they have one word to a face. And you spin them around, and you can look here. You can see that the upper wheel, no matter how you spin the wheels, it makes sentences because of the rules of grammar. So we were sort of talking about Chomsky and linguistics in this exhibit and telling people how language is structured. And the lower wheel, the structural rules are broken, so they kind of end up being like poetry, but they're not real sentences, but they sort of are evocative. So it's kind of the difference between structured and non-structured language. But the thing that always blew my mind about this exhibit, that and all the best exhibits at the Science Center have a deeper level to them, just the mathematics of it, the 10 faces on each wheel times the 9 wheels, like that's 10 to the 9. That's a billion sentences. So with just 90 words, and I still remember coming up with which would be the right words for this exhibit and working with the designers on this, but just 90 words creates a billion sentences. And think of all the words we're all carrying around in our heads. And from this, and this is just sort of an amazing testament to evolution, where something finite like the human brain can deal with something infinite like all the possibilities of the universe, all the knowledge we could ever hope to have. Language is generative. That was the point that we made with that exhibit. Something finite can give you something infinite. And for that reason, most of us go through most of our lives speaking sentences that we've never said before. We just keep opening our mouths, saying things that, well, I know that in our household there are some sentences that are said more than once. But mostly. And I still think about this exhibit more than 20 years later. Every time I sit down in front of the computer, every time I'm figuring out how to write a lead, I'm thinking I'm about to write something, I hope, that I've never written before. And so that's just sort of a little slice of life from my time at the Science Center. That's the how. People still playing with that exhibit right now. When I think of the when question, I'm going to zoom forward in time to the present, to my current role. covering science for the Globe and Mail. That means covering science for Canadians, but also science in Canada. And science in Canada has some incredible treasures. Among them, up here, up in the Rockies, this is in eastern British Columbia, right near the Alberta border, where I had a chance to hike up higher than the CN Tower. I'll never forget that climb, because the first 30 minutes, it's like, I hope I don't see a grizzly bear. And then the next 90 minutes is, I hope I don't have a heart attack. The bear thing is, you know, that's lower priority now. So anyway, but up there, way up in these craggy crags, is a fossil find that Jean-Bernard Caron at the Royal Ontario Museum and colleagues have come across. It's of the same vintage as the Burgess Shale, but it samples a different part of that ecosystem, and they're discovering new species and seeing new things. And to me, I like this example because here's Jean-Bernard Caron. He was carrying pool noodles when I followed him up the hill that day. And you wonder why, because you need the pool noodles to wrap the edges of those bits of shale that are being pulled out of the cliff. And you can sort of see them in layers right there. So it was a very colorful climb, but an arduous one. Anyway, he pointed out to me that day a fossil that stayed with me. It's a Sydnea. You can just sort of see this thing that it's not much to look at. I'm not going to say more. I'm going to show you. I'm going to try to, let's see, hopefully we'll get the audio here. I'm going to try. Let's see if we get the audio. There's the story as it appeared. Let's see if the audio comes up. It is. Okay. So what you're hearing is just the raw interview. I'm just holding a tape recorder. He's showing me things. People are working in the background. And just listen and see if you can spot what's going to be the lead of the story.
There's a worm here that we need to describe. And there's this beautiful cinnea, which is an arthropod preserved obliquely with all the limbs preserved here on the side, the head, and good content. So that's the traces of the last meal of this animal preserved on that fossil. Now, light is a bit of an issue here, but you can recognize the segments of the arthropod and the tail. So this is a good specimen. It's preserved obliquely, so suggesting that it was tumbled quickly. Now, this arthropod is actually relatively common. We find them across the entire section. I'm going to show you a series of examples, so for other examples here of fossils that we got. This is another one here with Cinea actually defecating. He was a bit stressed, I guess, during burial 500 million years ago. And there's also Metaspergina here, the fish. You can see the chevron leg structure, and those are.
So maybe you just heard that about the Cinea defecating. He was a bit stressed, I guess, in that lovely accent. So I sometimes play that for students because, you know, that's halfway through an hour-long recording. And, you know, when you're in that situation, you're in the field, you're thinking to yourself, what's going to be my lead? Where do I start this story? What's the place where I can give the reader something to hold on to, bring them in? And those moments just flip by. Like, you know, and if you're looking the other way, you won't hear them or you won't see them. But right away, as soon as he said that and I didn't say anything, I thought, that's probably going to be the lead of the story. And in fact, I'll just tell you how the story unfolded by the time it came to print. High up in the mountains of British Columbia's Kootenay National Park, the exact location a secret, Jean-Bernard Caron shows me a slab of rock pried from the cliff face where we are standing. I can see something embedded in the surface that to my untrained eye is little more than a gray-on-gray blob the size of a flattened tennis ball. Nothing I would suspect as having once been alive. But to Dr. Caron, curator of invertebrate paleontology at the Royal Ontario Museum, the blob is immediately recognizable as Cydnea inexpectans, an ancient species of arthropod that would have looked like a cross between a jumbo shrimp and a sow bug. Dr. Caron points out the traces of feather-like appendages. Then he tells me exactly what it was doing the moment it died. Defecating, actually, he says, indicating a darker splotch projecting from what I presume was the creature's rear end. He was a bit stressed, I guess, during burial. No kidding. 1 minute, about 508 million years ago, the hapless arthropod was ambling along the seafloor near an underwater cliff. The next, it was caught up in a mudslide and swept into oxygen-starved waters, where it suffocated under a thick blanket of silt, along with a menagerie of other weird beasts. Now those creatures are seeing the light of day for the first time since their abrupt demise, and so on and so on. So, of course, this was a feature, and typically, and this ran in our focus section of the Globe, these leads get worked on a lot. This is one case where it just came out in one shot. And even though that story was edited many times, the editor never changed a word of the lead. It just wrote itself. And it was just moments like that. So when I think of my favorite whens, there are a lot of whens at the Globe and Mail, especially like, when is the story going to be filed. But that's one of my favorite whens, that moment 508 million years ago, which is now frozen in time for our benefit. I'm going to treat you to one who, and of course, in this type of work, you get to meet all kinds of incredible people. Some of my favorite who's are people I ran into when I worked at New Scientist. When I was bureau chief in Boston, that's when New Scientist launched a podcast. I produced and co-hosted that podcast, and over 2 years, we had over 80 episodes, and just had some fabulous conversations and built up an audience, I think, of over 50,000 people. And it was amazing. We got an email from Fiji and Denmark and all over the place, and you have this sense of sharing experience with listeners. Very informed by my time at Discovery Channel and my time as a listener of CBC. So out of all, and some of the people that we had on the show, Richard Dawkins, Noam Chomsky, Tim Berners-Lee, who launched the internet, I can think of many others, Sherry Turkle, Paul Davies, and so on. I have to say that one interview that really sticks with me is I went over to Harvard one day and sat down with E.O. Wilson, and we talked for about 90 minutes. And in the end, the conversation was so rich that we just made a two-part special. We did edit it down a little bit, but it was basically an hour of E.O. Wilson, and it was just a joy to speak to him. He's now 87. He's an amazing scientist, also Pulitzer Prize winner, beautifully spoken. We were speaking about his book, The Creation. It's a book he wrote about 10 years ago. You might remember it, but he was kind of making an appeal to evangelists about why they needed to protect the planet too, and how it was part of their moral sensibility to do that. So I make it a point that I don't ask for autographs, but I made an exception that day, and I really appreciated him drawing his little signature ant in my copy of the book. Here's what it sounded like when I asked him. After we sort of finished talking about the evangelists, what's your advice for young people? And I thought this, for getting young people interested in nature, and I thought this audience especially would appreciate his answer. So here's just a couple minutes of E.O. Wilson answering that question.
In the book, you also write about education, in particular of the very young. You've got a chapter about how to create a naturalist or how to raise a naturalist. I'm wondering what advice you would have for parents, for teachers of young children who are trying to foster that appreciation for the natural world, for biodiversity, in hopes of a greener tomorrow.
Even where parents themselves did not develop it, didn't have the opportunity to develop a feeling for the natural world and all that it can offer them, just to provide it to their children to fill out their potential is good advice. And it's certainly true that, like the development of a musician, the development of a mathematician, the development of what? A very religious person. Early exposure in pleasant circumstances is the best way to make a naturalist. And it's not hard to see how that's done. What you do is you take a child into the field. You give them the experience of being not just more knowledgeable about different kinds of trees and birds and so on, that can be deadly dull if it's treated as just one more exercise in learning and education. But let them, with encouragement, become explorers, adventurers, treasure hunters. That's the way to do it. Little children are savages. They are Paleolithic creatures who have a strong desire to explore, and to explore on their own or in small groups. They don't need to be taught in the early stages of that exploration. They need rather to be given the opportunity to go forth as adventurers. Children have, it's well established now, an innate desire between the ages of roughly 9 and 12 to build tree houses or little retreats where they can go all on their own, preferably in the woods if they can get there. They really want to explore. They love it. They will catch butterflies. They should be allowed to mess up nature a little bit. They should be turned loose in places where they can bring back a frog or a snake or a spider in a jar. Rachel Carson said once, take a child to the seashore. She was always looking to the sea. And let them explore tidal pools. Don't tell them what the creatures are. Let them find them and then talk with them later about what the creatures are. And with that, a kind of early experience, you can make a lifetime naturalist.
E.O. Wilson, thank you so much for speaking with me today.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Just that bit about children should be allowed to mess up nature a little bit has really stayed with me. That one quote could be pulled out for a magazine story or profile, but it's just so lovely to hear it in its full, the full length, and just to hear his, you know, warm tones, and he's a very, very pleasant man. So just moving on to the what. I spent 2.5 years as U.S. news editor at Nature in Washington, D.C. We were very policy-focused. It was an interesting time. It was a transition from the Bush era to the Obama era. There were plenty of questions to be asked about science funding, science policy in the U.S., and all kinds of other interesting things to chase down with the, you know, $100-odd billion or so that the U.S. spends on science each year. We covered NIH and NSF and NASA, lots of individual researchers. We covered misconduct. We covered, you know, shenanigans with drug companies, kind of trying to, you know, change our perception of research and so on. All of those things were serious business, and I was really fortunate in Nature to work with an incredibly talented team of reporters and to be part of Nature's global news team. It was an incredible education for me that I take with me every day. I don't think I could cover all the different areas of science that I do at the Globe and Mail without drawing on all those fabulous seasoned reporters that I worked with at Nature. But I'm just going to pick out one little story, and it's because at Nature, in addition to great writers, we also had great editors, and we had sub-editors, which you don't have so much in North America, but in those of you who are familiar with the UK journalist business will know. And in Nature, the sub-editors have a special role. So they're sort of the editors who pick up the copy after the editors, and after the top edit and so on. And what their job is, I mean, it's not exactly copy editing, although they will do that too. But they're there to protect the brand. They're there to protect the reader from you, the reporter or the editor who signed the reporter, all the way up the line. They're the last line of defense, and they are incredibly exacting. And they can be exacting, you know, just as the printing presses are rolling. So it can be an unbelievably nerve-wracking experience every week when Nature goes to press. I sometimes say that the point of the sub-editors at Nature is not to make a great journal, and Nature is a great journal. It's so that, and it's not for anyone who's reading Nature today. It's for a trillion years from now, when a more advanced civilization comes and digs through the rubble of whatever's here on Earth, and they find a copy of Nature, and they say, those sub-editors at Nature, they knew what they were doing. That's their audience. We had a short story about a type of genetically modified grass. It was written by Heidi Ledford, fabulous reporter who covers biotech, and she also has an interest in botany, so she loved this grass story. And it was an interesting story because it kind of anticipates what's happening now with CRISPR. This type of transgenic grass, it was modified genetically using a bacteria. It was a method that regulations didn't cover. So even though the genome was changed, it wasn't really GMO. Now, it wasn't for consumption. It was Kentucky bluegrass. But what was interesting for us about the story was, here's something that's been genetically modified that, you know, is not going to be regulated by, the USDA. And so that was the story. You only have a certain amount of room to write a headline. And I worked with kind of the page layout. And in writing the headline, a headline came to me that I could not resist. But it involved a pun. And so this was not good. You don't do that kind of thing. And yet, I just couldn't resist. So sent it in. The sub-editors resisted. I resisted back. You know, the print deadline was looming. We called in, the chief editor. It went higher up the chain of command. It became a war. But by God, I was going to get this headline done. And I have to thank Tim Appenzeller. He's now with Science, but he was my boss in Nature at the time, where I think he finally said, "What's the harm?" But it was with just great bitterness that the sub-editors allowed this headline through. And I've often said that some far distant future, I would like to be buried with this issue of Nature, that I managed to get this headline in. So if you go to Nature, volume 475, page 274. What was all the fuss? You would not believe how many gray hairs came out of this headline. And there were discussions afterwards. But we got it through, and I'm very proud of it. And when it came time for me to move on, my colleagues at Nature gave me my own Nature cover, and they put me in a grass skirt. So I just had to share that with you. So sometimes the hardest part of the job happens behind closed doors. So I'm just going to finish off now with a where, and when I go to where, I have to think about my time at Discovery Channel, which was a really fabulous, exciting time. And of course, when you're doing television, where is the key question, because where are we going, where are we setting up the camera, and where are we going, what are we going to be looking at? What's the first shot going to be? I spent lots of time. It wasn't just about Mars at the Discovery Channel, but it was a lot of Mars. When I was there, we covered all the Mars landings, and I took viewers to places that were like Mars on Earth. There's Houghton Crater on Ellesmere Island, where I went in 2003. There's Rio Tinto in Spain, where Mars researchers were looking at some of the acidic waters there and the interactions with the rock as a Mars analog. There's the real Mars in the background. There's me pretending to be Steve Squires, who was the chief scientist for the Mars rovers and a constant character in our stories. But I'm not going to talk about Mars. I'm going to talk instead about Tom Thompson and something that's very close to this institute because of Algonquin Park. Tom Thompson, I've always been, I'm Canadian. I like Tom Thompson. I'm sure many of you are. But I have not thought, I had not thought about him for a while until in around 2003, I was in Ottawa. We went to a show at the National Gallery. It was the big Tom Thompson show that ran about 10 years ago. And what really caught my eye were not just the iconic pictures, but the sketches. And as in case you don't know, you probably learn all of this in school now, but in case you don't know, the way Tom Thompson worked, he would take he would spend his winters in Toronto and then take the train up to Algonquin Park and do his fishing and guiding and so on, and do these little sketches out in the wilderness, just on tiny little boards, little board panels about this big. He'd have his sketch box. There's a little sketch box right there. And so what you're seeing here are not his masterpieces, but the sketches that led to the masterpieces. These were tiny little sketches that became the inspiration for the great Tom Thompson works that we know so well. So at that exhibit, I saw this little sketch from 1917. So this was the last year of Thompson's life. he got there and painted starting in April, and then he drowned in July of that year. So the sketches that we have from that spring are the masterpieces that were never made. And I sometimes look at this one and I think about whether or not this iconic, you know, whether there would have been an iconic masterpiece by Tom Thompson of the Northern Lights. But there was something that caught my eye when I looked at this because I'd never seen it like this way before. Many of the astronomers in the audience will see it right away. There's a very familiar constellation here. It's the W constellation of Cassiopeia. And it just never occurred to me before that that he was painting a real scene. I mean, of course I knew he was painting a real scene, but he's not just randomly putting dots in the sky for stars the way most people would think, oh, those are just dots. He's painting the real stars in their actual positions, and it's a quite a good representation of that constellation. And so realizing that the stars were real and their orientation was correct, it made me think, oh, this is not just sort of an idea of Northern Lights. This is an actual event in history that happened. It had a time, and therefore it also had a place. I wonder where that place was. And, of course, you can see the horizon. It looks like there's some bumpy hills, but those aren't really hills. Those are the bottoms of the auroral curtain. But there's a darker landscape in front. And I'll just have a little line here. Here's the constellation Cassiopeia that looks like a W. And this yellow line at the bottom is the actual horizon. You can see it in the painting, in the sketch, because it's just two slightly different shades of kind of dark paint. And so there's this question, like, where could that have been? Would it even be possible? Well, first of all, who knows when this was? He was all over Algonquin Park, if this even was Algonquin Park. You could just imagine how you would try to look at thousands and thousands of places where someone might have done a simple sketch like this. But because the constellation was in a certain position, that only corresponds to certain times of day and certain times of the year. And very quickly, I realized, you know, you might actually be able to narrow this down. And this was one of those moments where I thought, it's too bad that there isn't a scientist doing this. You know, there's a fellow from Texas, Don Olson, who does a lot of this with Van Gogh paintings and so on. You know, we need someone like that. And it just dawned on me. Well, you know, one thing science and journalism have in common is you don't need a license. So I thought, well, I'll try it. So I got out all the computer software, you know, oriented the constellation so it looked like the painting, started to figure out what times of night and year those corresponded to, and I quickly came to the conclusion that most of the time you see Cassiopeia like this is in the middle of the winter. So it can't be then. In fact, he could only have seen this very, very early in the morning in November, which is unlikely, or in the evening in April, just around the time that he's coming up. And because it's April, and you can even see a hint of it at the bottom of the painting, there's still ice on the lake. So you can't get far. It's not like canoeing all around Algonquin Park. It's trudging around on snowshoes. And he stayed at Mowat Lodge, which was near the train depot there. So this probably was in walking distance of Mowat Lodge. So then it suddenly went from thousands of possible places to maybe half a dozen. So then, with a little more research, my cameraman at Discovery Channel, Ross McIntosh, went up with me. We spent, a couple days traipsing around Algonquin Park. And I remember very well how we started checking off the possibilities. We really narrowed it down. By the time we were there, we narrowed it down to three. And then very quickly, one of those three looked completely not right. It had to be, you know, you're looking northeast here. It has to be on the western shore of Canoe Lake. There are only so many places where you can have exposure and you're out from the trees where you can see things. And so first we went to one, and it was clearly not the right place. There was one more left, and we thought, well, this it's either this or we're totally wrong and the whole thing is a wash. And Ross said, well, let me go there first to shoot you coming and seeing if it's true or not. And I said, yeah, but that's not going to be television. Like, the people watching TV will know it's fake because they'll know that you were there first because you're filming me coming to it. And so then, and we had someone from the park there who was helping guide us. And Ross and I basically proceeded to have this big argument about what was good TV or not good TV. And finally he gave in and was, and, you know, his artistry was, he was just shaken that he wanted to just, anyway, and so he showed the back of me as we were going through the woods, and we came out to this spot, and so this is what we saw. So, oh, why, here's Canoe Lake, and sorry, I realize I do have a pointer, actually, and I wonder if I can do it. Yeah, so we had tried a number of these different points. We finally came to this point right here, which is not far from Mowat Lodge, and looked northeast, and here's the painting again with the line of the horizon, and here's what we saw that day. And, you know, it's a small thing, but it still sends shivers up my spine when I think about it. That site is an eyesight of where Tom Thompson drowned in Canoe Lake. It's one of the last paintings he did, one of the last sketches he did. And even though, you know, this is not an earth-shattering story in terms of a great Nobel Prize-winning discovery or an investigative report that exposes something, you know, astonishing, there was so much response to this story. I think it just touched everybody, and I still, you know, I still feel connected to Tom Thompson when I think about stepping out onto that rock and realizing we were looking at the right place. So that still stands as my favorite wear, and there's that picture one more time. The why question is the last one, and I'm not going to tell a story. I'm just going to acknowledge all of the universities I've been affiliated with over the years. I got my journalism degree at Boston University. I did a night fellowship at MIT. I spent a year at MIT and Harvard doing whatever I wanted, which is basically having heaven in the middle of your life instead of the end. Carleton University is the one place in Canada where you can take a course in reporting on science, medicine, and health, and I've had a long association with that course, which is taught by Catherine O'Hara since its beginnings 20 years ago. So these are all the universities that I've been connected with, and most of all, I want to acknowledge the University of Toronto and the Dunlop Institute for Astronomy and Astrophysics. Between my time at New Scientist and Nature, I spent a year here at U of T, kind of coming full circle, and during that time was a Massey Fellow with the Massey Journalism Fellows. It was during that time that we created Cosmic Vistas with Oasis Channel, a very successful 30-episode television series. And also it was a time that connected me in a way I hadn't before with sort of the larger circle of Canadian media. And I think probably laid the seeds for eventually me coming to the Globe and Mail, you know, maybe 5 or 6 years later. So I say all of this because the one other thing that came out of this was this class that I teach for graduate students in the sciences at U of T on science journalism. And it's doing that, or when I speak to scientists when I speak to students at Carleton, or sometimes if I go back to BU and speak to students there, it's these connections to the university where I'm talking to students that I realize that's where I really have to defend what I do. And it's amazing how often if I'm telling students, you know, this is how you write a lead, or this is how you do a story, or these are the kinds of questions you should be asking, or this is why this matters. And then I go back to my, you know, I just look at what I've written in the paper that week and ask myself if I met that bar as I'm kind of barking it out to them. And so that has been incredibly invaluable to me, and I just need to acknowledge U of T and thank everyone who's been involved in supporting that and supporting that communication. So there's a takeaway message to all of this. You can see that it wasn't one job or one lucky break or one episode in my life. It was the sum total of it all. So in all of these episodes and all of the places I've worked, you know, and in all the family and friends around me, I had support. There were role models I could follow. There was the right education at the right time. There were opportunities. travel, all sorts of things. There was a community of people I could feel and, kind of connected to. There was mentorship, internships, fellowships, and of course, importantly, there were jobs for me to go from one place to another. You never quite know how it's going to work out, but there were enough landing points to build enough experience to do what I'm doing now. And I'm saying all of this because I can't tell you all to go out and hire more science journalists, but I can ask you to think about how you might encourage landing points for people as they are progressing, even when they don't know that they're moving in that direction. Yes, our media is challenged. The model is changing. We don't know how we're going to be receiving news in 10 or 20 or 30 years. But there will be journalism. There is a need for information in the public interest. And because we're in a society that depends crucially on science and technology, there will be and there needs to be science journalism. Canada absolutely needs to have that as well. So just think about that in your lives, how you can encourage it, how you can help support platforms where people might be hopping their way. It's the kind of profession where there isn't a straight line, and there shouldn't be. It doesn't need to be a straight line to get to be a science journalist here or there. There just need to be enough landing places. So with that, I want to say one final thank you. This is my favorite family portrait. I'm the guy down in the middle with his feet near Mars. My wife, Shelley, is up a little bit higher, and my three daughters, Bella, Ava, and Nico, are all there, too. I want to thank them for all their support every single day that I go to work. And thank you all for this marvelous prize.
Thank you.